Hello and welcome back to another episode of Critical Reactions with your host Brian. We are going to wrap up today with a special selection, which is where one of you tell me exactly what it is I need to check out. Today's suggestion comes at us from Dawson Brugel. The mixture of soundscapes and emotion in this one. The blend of extreme metal, folk, and melody-themed motives are sweet as honey throughout this song. It's a magical ride, both the album and the song, and one I should not miss. So, let's dive into this. We got Wilderun. The track is called Passenger. Let's dive into this and see what they're bringing to the table today. Unless I miscounted that is a 19 beat phrase. Massive too, we got some very theatric. Beautiful voice. So really cool 5-4 there, into a 6-8, into a 4-4, yeah, I'm going to stop with the time signature counting, but this is all over the place. That guitar squeal going into this like all low end stuff. It's like an organ thing going on in the background. We got a harp too. There is so much going on in here. So we had some mystery, vibrancy, some sort of angelicness, power maybe. Whoa, talk about a tonal shift, golly. That harmony. love the dual movement between our bass guitar and the violin. Oh no, regular guitar and violin. Okay. I love that line. Sort of like that creeping. So good. There's a big brassy texture, but I don't hear brass. Yeah, so the choir rhythm pairing well with the drummer while the guitar has their own rhythm. The keyboard just took over the guitar's line. The guitar was leading that chordal half-step rise, and then the organ took it, presumably so the guitar could prepare for this riff. Putting the octave on it. That quick cymbal hit there at the end. It was on like a, I don't know, one of those upside down cymbals. It was really chunky sounds. Yeah, so using that quick texture on the picking to introduce the quick tom line that the drum started on. Yeah, starting to open it up. Like little cracks are seeping through. Little menacing and ominous. Yeah, that half step down too. A lot of tension right there. That's not a half step, is it? That's our second. Cool. There is brass. Oh, they didn't go for it. They alluded to it, but they ducked out. Oh, that string line. Oh, yes. maybe the lyrics will make that ending make more sense. Because the thing is so... Oh, man, that was a ride. We done? Yeah, we done. All right, so here's the thing, right? So, like, I was directing that rising idea, and we should have hit the octave, right? And then held it out. Would have been a fantastic little ending to it. We probably could have thrown a fifth in there. Just really... fifth, maybe even a third in there. Just get this really strong chord to finish the track out. Really triumphant ending. And then maybe get some guitar riffage for like 8 bars to wrap the song up. That's where I thought they were going, but they didn't. They went for that high note. The brass hit it and backed off immediately to make way for that really whimsical, adventurous violin line to come in with the brass supporting it with this power. And like, this section was really cool, but it was an odd thing to do after alluding to this big finale. And then even stranger is that they had all this energy and then they just cut it down and go to like, what was it? Just a solo acoustic guitar to finish out the track. Just... totally unexpected. Everything up to that point I felt had strong direction, strong indication of direction. Everything felt like it was going exactly where it should. Everything that was added onto, every layer tossed in, felt natural. Everything seemed to flow very well. And the ending, I like the psych out. I think those are cool. I still would have really loved to hear just this really big, powerful moment there. But the psych out, doing this sforzando to pull away the volume and bring in the other. I mean, the whimsical section by itself in a vacuum was cool. So I'm glad we got to hear that. And it was part of a psych out, so that was cool too. But then just slashing the song down for 2 bars of the acoustic guitar, man, it makes no sense to me. If anybody has a different read on that, maybe when we hit the lyrics, it'll make sense. Like, there's a thematic reason, a narrative reason why, because this feels like a journey, right? I don't know if this is a concept album, but this feels like a conceptual song. I'd chalk up a lot of the less cohesive jumps, because we do have some really strange jumps in here from one mode to another without any foreshadowing or anything like that on them to tie them together. But I chalk up most of that to thematic writing, right? There's something that's going on in the lyrics, a story that's being told that the music is going with and amplifying. But the ending, I really hope there's a lyrical reason for that, because it just... it is a sour taste in my mouth after a phenomenal 9 minutes and 50... we'll call it 49 seconds, right? The last 9 to 10 seconds of it were just a very strange decision. But maybe it's not, right? Maybe it makes sense in a larger context of the work. Wow, this was a joy to listen to. That did not feel like 10 minutes to me. So many great elements. I mean, we can't not talk about orchestration. Both instrumental choice and compositional layering. There are just so many parts of this track that feel... man, the layers are just perfect, right? You think the song sounds perfect as it is, and then they throw in, some brass around it, and you're like, oh, you know, this is great. You know, I'm glad they did that. You know, when are we going to move on to the next section? And then they're like, nope, also strings. And you're like, oh, you know, that's the whipped cream on this ice cream. You know, this is phenomenal. I'm really glad you did that. What's coming next? And they're like, also, we got a cherry on top here. Let's do a solo idea up here. And we'll embellish the brass line with an organ concept. And you're like, this is amazing. I'm glad we didn't go anywhere. I'm glad we stuck with this and kept building it. And that's... that's what I felt like the whole time. A kid in a candy shop. Every time I turned a corner, there was something else I didn't know I wanted. I'd never seen that candy before, but I'm glad that I was introduced to this, and I'm glad I get to try it. Which actually doesn't really work perfectly as an analogy, because a lot of this is exactly what I was expecting. I wasn't expecting it to be as well done as it was. There are a lot of flourishes in here that I don't typically associate with symphonic metal. It's the kind of symphonic metal I've been asking for. This very perfectly pairs. This is good because, like, I've been asking for this for so long, and you guys gave me Seven Spires, which I thought did a phenomenal job of marrying the metal and the orchestral stuff. I still haven't dug into their other two albums. It is on my list, I promise. If you're interested in that, I mean, it was a pretty lengthy video, but we checked out their entire Solveig album. But yeah, so that was just like, what, 3 weeks ago maybe? And today, Wilderun is a band I've heard of before, so I'm going to say reintroduced to them. Yeah, we've checked out the Unimaginable Zero Summer. Oh, and the thumbnail, I wrote Masters of Musical Storytelling. That was very much what most of this was going to be. They really are good at that. I don't know why they never ended up on my listen list. That needs to get corrected ASAP. But yeah, just another really good band that merges the metal and the symphonic, bringing in both strengths and not really having to give up any strengths of either side and introduce any cons. Because, you know, sometimes you bring in too much classical and the metal is just a texture, right? Your guitar ends up doing chords and you get that gritty, distorted, overdriven sound around your orchestra, and that's all they do. And the other side of the spectrum is when you bring in the strings, but they just do what your guitars are doing, or they just do chords and you get their texture around your metal. A lot of bands end up going one way or the other like that. And I found very few symphonic metal bands that can do this and just really ride it down the middle and bring in the best of classical writing with a full, you know, with a large set of instruments, and the best of metal's writing with their aggressive and edge and bite, and bringing it together into a track that feels like classical. Yeah, well, it feels like symphonic metal, as the name implies, or at least implies to me. I'm expecting symphonic music with metal music, not just elements of one with the core of the other. It's just, it's done so well. But, you know, I was saying, oh, yeah, but that everything I expected was, or everything that happened was what I expected, but just not here. And, if you've ever listened to adventurous classical music, and I'm going to even go out on a limb and just say, if you've ever listened to movie soundtracks or even video game soundtracks, especially more adventurous, sometimes even fantasy oriented stuff, you're going to hear a lot of what happened in here. And I called it theatric at the beginning. And I think that the more I listened, the more I agreed with myself, which is a weird phrase to say. This is very theatric, not just because of its width or grandiosity or anything like that, but because it borrows so much of the composition details, the embellishments, the flourishes that classical music typically utilizes, often in the realm of action-based soundtrack work. And so at the beginning, I was like, oh, you know, that's awesome. I'm glad they did that. Oh, I'm glad they brought this in. This is beautiful. But about the halfway point, my brain shifted gears. I'm not listening to a metal band. I'm listening to a classical composer who happens to have a metal band in his score. And I shifted over to a soundtrack-oriented listening style. And yeah, then everything started clear. You'll probably notice around like the 5-6 minute mark into this reaction, I started, you know, using my hands to dictate and predict what would happen next. I really got a feel for their composition style, and it's because it lines up with my own expectations for music in this vein, which is just really cool. And it's really interesting coming off of what we just listened to, which is for the positive confusion theme, in which I had no idea what would come around next. And this was just a really nice opposite end of the spectrum for me after losing my mind talking about, what was that, The Garden? If you're interested in that, I'll put the little dude up there. That was just, I mean, I lost my mind listening to that and trying to figure it out. And to come to this where everything is exactly as I want, as I expect. Whew. All right, so I have spent like, I don't know, 10 minutes gushing about the band and their vision. Let's talk about the song in particular. Now there's, as usual, you're probably tired of hearing me say this, but I gotta say it for new people. This song is incredibly dense. I'm going to dig in as deep as I can, but I guarantee it's going to be a bit more surface level than other reactions just because there is so much going on here in each individual moment, but it's also a fairly complex track overall. It doesn't follow a typical verse-chorus-verse-chorus concept, so it's not even like I can, you know, divide out half the song to repetitive concepts. It's just a lot of stuff going on. So yeah, this is going to be a little more surface level than usual. Let's dig into this. First of all, the metal band. We got guitars, we got bass, we got drums, we got these gorgeous vocals. Love the dude's vocals. All of this is laid out very well in traditional metal stylings. We have this, well, the vocals kind of have a bit of a crossover. It's just this really nice, clean, projected, theatrical style of singing. And there, here's the thing. I've talked about this before. I don't think I've ever explained what I mean by this, though. In theater, there's no microphones. So theater acting and theater singing both require a lot of projection and, hopefully, a good acoustic area. So you're not shouting. So that people in the back can hear you, but you do need to project. You need a lot of power. You need a lot of resonance, and that's why you'll often hear, especially for vocalists in this range, have more of an O sound instead of eh. It's O. You're still hitting that same note, give or take. I'm not a singer. I think I was close, but instead of the oh, you're getting more of an open sound of the throat rather than this like forward placed sound. Again, I'm not a vocal coach. Go find someone else to better explain this stuff. But by doing that, by having this strong sound placed at the back of the mouth, it creates more space for resonance and gets this projection, but it also adds, at least to my ear, a little bit more bass sound to it. And so you get a very full resonant tone out of the vocals. And there's also just a lot of power behind there. There's really strong air pressure that helps it feel extremely powerful and large. It's a very theatrical style of singing. And it's just because the skills there are, well, the requirements there are different than when you're singing directly into a microphone, as if you're, you know, recording in a studio or doing a live performance. Your volume doesn't have to all come from you because you have a sound system. So he just has a very theatric style of singing, but the band and that theatric style of singing has, you know, there's metal has used it before, but it also kind of comes from more of the traditional classical side too. So that's why I said it kind of bridges the gap. And I think it actually does that well. I hadn't thought of that before. But, you know, the metal does metal stuff. I'm about to explain that. The strings and the brass, they all do their classical stuff. The vocals are the bridge that tie it all together. They fit in both worlds. They got a foot in both. Huh. Anyways, the metal band does metal stuff. The bass does... They have cool bass lines every once in a while. But a lot of the time, they're sort of riding the pedal tone. And echoing the rhythm of the bass kick. I heard that a lot, but there's also a ton of stuff in here that covers up the lower end stuff, especially when the lower end stuff, like what I think are tubas, it's a lower end brassy sound. And I think I heard a cello in there one time. That stuff is huge. Right. I think it covers up the bass, and there's probably quite a few times that I didn't hear any bass because I was just listening to everything else going on. So the bass might have been a bit more active than I recall, but I did hear them sitting on a pedal tone often. They occasionally had some really nice bass lines, some moving ideas, pretty typical metal bass stuff. Our guitars often jump between, oh, this is really cool, riffs, chords, melodies, and textures. And I thought this was phenomenal. This is something that guitars and just metal in general does very well. And that's the rule of cool style of composition. It doesn't really matter if there's a term for it. It doesn't matter if you're sonically accurate. It doesn't matter if you're consonant or dissonant. It doesn't matter what any of that means. Does it sound cool to play? Can you bang your head to it? Nod your head to headbang, right? Nod your head to it, then it's cool, and we're going to play it, right? That's metal's whole MO in my mind. Obviously, metal's branched out in a lot of ways, and we have more theory being injected into metal in different subgenres, but for the most part, metal to me is rule of cool, right? Does it sound cool? Then we're putting it in our song. And a lot of that rule of cool comes down to texture. This is something that, while is utilized in classical music sometimes and to some extent, even just by definition of timbre, the reason the brass gets certain lines and not the woodwinds is because the timbre of the brass, the texture of their sound, better supports this line. But it's not quite as often, especially not as often as metal does it, that we'll utilize odd sounds in the instruments, which is even a weird way to put that, right? When you think of a guitar, you can do a pick slide, you can do the whammy, you can do a slide, you can do hammer-ons and pull-offs, you can finger pick. You know, there's so many different ways. And then we even have people like, who was it, Van Halen back in the day, who played with like a drill or something so that he could get different timbres out of it. Like, there are no rules in metal. As long as you can make a sound that sounds cool, you can do it. But classical just doesn't really take that approach to texture. The instrument has a sound. That's how we'll use it. Sometimes we'll modify that with proper equipment, such as mutes and stuff. But for the most part, your instrument has a texture, and that's it. And so when we get stuff like, I was talking about that really quick, like a muted pick scrape or something that was, I don't know, it was near the end. And it was just this really percussive sound coming from the guitar, really quick. And it was like this moment of like anticipation. That and the drums, I think, were the only thing that was going on. We don't hear anything like that from the rest of the band, you know, from the strings or the brass or anything like that. That is the metal side. They bring texture to the equation. And I just think it's awesome that while the guitars mostly did melodic and harmonic ideas throughout this entire track, you know, the riffs and the chords and the solos and melodies, there were two sections where they brought that metal rule of cool. We don't have a name. Well, there probably is a name for it. I don't know what the name for the technique is because I don't even know what the technique was. But it sounds cool to do. It creates tension and anticipation, so we're going to do it. Right? And I think that's just really awesome. The drums are just doing drum things. We get crazy, you know, lots of attacks all over the place sections. We get groove. We get, what's the other thing? Metronome style, just kind of sitting in the pocket, laying down the time signature for everybody. Time signature, we got to talk about that. And so, like, they're doing what a metal band would do. They're not really written like an orchestra. If we took the orchestra out of this, I think just these core three instruments plus the vocals would still make a rather competent track. There might be a couple of sections that are a bit iffy. We might have to, you know, give the violin line to a guitar because now there's nothing playing here, right? So we all have to pass one of the ideas. But for the most part, I think the song would still function. It would nowhere it wouldn't be anywhere near as good, but it would still be a functional song. And that's going to be true for the other side as well. What we get out of this larger instrumentation is width, power. We get interchangeable timbres. You know, this is something I've talked about before. When you have a four-piece rock band, if your bassist stops playing, you lose the low end of your track. Everybody has a designated role with no overlap. And that's not true in an orchestra, right? Flutes and trumpets share pretty much the same range, but they have very different timbres. And like I just got done talking about, one's going to be given different lines than another based on their strengths as an instrument, of the color of their sound. So, you know, you can have the flutes and woodwinds and, you know, clarinets and oboes and stuff come in and do something, and then they can stop playing and the brass will play. And these are two vastly different sections now. Even if you pass on the same exact ideas and just change the volume, right? From quiet maybe to loud on the brass, and now you have a very different sound for this basically just copy-pasted technique. And that's what the wider orchestration brings to the table, is that you have a bunch of voices to play around with. None of them have to be present at all times. And we also just have a lot of voices, and you can play around with that, where one instrument passes an idea to another instrument before they start taking up something, and then that first phrase gets passed to another instrument, and this middle instrument now takes a new idea. Now we have this massive, like, three-way melody thing going on. And, like, there's just so much you can do because you have so many choices. And that's really what a wide orchestra brings to the equation. And through these choices, you get a lot of decisions. And maybe a lesser composer might assign multiple instruments to the same line to stack them up. And I say lesser composer. That's not a bad decision. Like, you know, everything's a tool in the toolbox, right? When the situation calls for it. I guess what I should have said is someone else might have just given all the orchestra the same line for the whole song, and it still would have sounded big and epic, but it would have lost that extra oomph, that extra special spice to make the song something great. Which is what happened here. We get little flourishes in the strings, and we get these overarching lines, and the brass come in to do rhythmic punctuations that are polyrhythmic to what our drums and guitar might be doing. And then there's a flute line over here, and it has like this really neat trill thing going on, and it's creating tension against the vocals. And like, there's just everything is just multi-layered, multifaceted all the time. There's rarely any moment when there isn't three or four things to pay attention to. For a critical listener to have that active listening skill going on, it is overwhelming, but it is phenomenal to just hear all the individual pieces going off. And for a casual listener, it's like one of those really good films that gets better with every watch because you notice different details. That's what this song is. That's what this writing style is good for. You might be able to listen to it 50 times and still hear something new. And it's just because it's so incredibly dense, but so perfectly composed and produced. We really can't forget about that angle as well. There are a lot of things going on, and in a more traditional orchestral setting, you just kind of record the room, and I don't know how much production goes into it, but the way that the instruments are laid out on the stage, especially if it is a theater hall designed for, you know, big performances like this, especially acoustic ones, a lot of, like I said, the placement of the instruments, where they are on the stage, where they are next to each other, that's all done for acoustic reasons to begin with. You don't really have to worry about placing instruments anywhere in the mix. Maybe you do some small tweaking things. Maybe there's a lot of production that I don't know about for classical settings like this. But it tends to be that what I hear in classical recordings is very similar to what I hear live. So maybe the producer's just really good. There's a lot of work that goes into that. But I kind of also get the idea that much like just having the live performance, you know, everything's kind of set up in a way that their minimal production would need to be done. But for something like this, where I'm going to assume it wasn't done in a concert hall, it was probably done in a recording studio, you might have to hand place every instrument in the mix and then hand tweak all the volume levels and EQ everything. And like, this could have been a very muddy, overlapping mess of a track, and it wasn't. The producer deserves a ton of credit for making this as clear as it is. Geez, we're at 35 minutes already. There are a ton of sections in the song. There are a ton of time signatures in the song. I started off at the beginning, and I had no idea what the time signature was. I counted 19 beats, and it started off with a really odd accent pattern where we did 7 beats and then 5 or something like that, and then I couldn't keep up. I don't remember what the pattern was. I counted out the whole thing, though, and I'm pretty sure I landed on 19, which is just odd. I suppose it could be 4-4 and 9-8, which would be 8-8 and 9-8. Well, no, that's 17. You can't add, Brian. even that, I mean, there's just no good way to divvy it up evenly in a traditional sense. I'm going to wager that it's just a really interesting compound time signature. It might even be 19-8 for all I know. And they might subdivide it differently in their heads, but it's written on paper as 19-8, which is a weird time signature, but it absolutely works for something like this. You know, you can go 10-8 and 9-8. Neither one of those are super common. You can make whatever time signature you want, though. But then after that, we did a section of like 4 bars of 5-4. And then a couple bars of 6-8 that led us into 4-4 or something like, I don't remember. It was complex, man. The time signature is all over the place. And the second time we hit this section, I wanted to show you guys, you know, here's the 5, right? And then I went to do the downbeat of the next bar of 5, and I felt like I was ahead. And I was like, wait, it started like the bar of 5 last time, but it was actually 6 this time? And then I was just like, I'm done. I'm not even going to try anymore. The time signature is just bonkers all over the place. And it is, it's impressive to me on a compositional level, you know. And I think this is interesting. You know, a lot of people, not a lot of people, I've seen a couple comments, I should say, where they're like, you know, just listen to the music, just feel it. You don't need to count everything out. And like, yeah, that's true. But there's also a really cool appreciation to understanding the magic of the song. And maybe that's just because I'm a tinkerer. I take everything apart. I want to know how things work. And music was no different for me. I want to know how it works. So I always find that really fascinating to see into the mind of the composers and how they think rhythmically, temporally. I mean, that's what time signature is. It's a control of time. It's an understanding of time. And to modify it like this kind of is controlling it. At least we control the time feel that the listener has. And it's just always fascinating to get into. But yeah, I did not pick up. There's a lot of meter changes in here. That's my read on that. there's so much to talk about. Anything that's worth, because like I can just sit here and gush about what I heard, but is it like the themes, right? What was going on in this track? There was intrigue, there was tension, there was malevolence, adventure. I would even say that the final segment was sort of adventurous. It felt like positive adventure, not like safe adventure, but like victorious, like. You had defeated your monster, right? Like fantasy realm stuff. And now you're riding your horse back home. Your task is finished. You come over the hill. And now, you know, you can finally see your house or your village or whatever. You know, it's still a bit further away. But, it you know, you can see it now. And those feelings of, you know, it's actually over now, right? are starting to crop up in you, and you still got like, you know, a 5-10 minute ride, and you know, you buck your horse and you start really going. You're like, I can't wait to get home. You know, you got all this energy, right? You were kind of weary from that massive trek back, but now it's over. You're in the home stretch, and that sense of accomplishment is really setting in. And that's what the final, you know, minute or so was, you know, when the string part came in and we had that fake out with the sforzando in the really high note. And we get this really nice section that's large, and we got this violin idea going on top of everything, and the guitars are coming in with their punchiness, the brass is sitting under everything and supporting it. And there's just like so many emotions in here. I don't remember them in an order to tell you a story, but it's fascinating to hear everything shift like this. Where I can say, you know, I listed five. There's probably more emotional, you know, sections, moments in this track. And they all flow together beautifully. There isn't any one section where I'm like, oh, that's kind of, you know, that doesn't fit the vibe of everything else. It doesn't make sense that we went here. And that right there is fascinating. And enthralling to listen to. It's like being told a really good novel. You know, a really good novel isn't flat. It's not one emotion all the way through. It's really about crafting as many emotions as is necessary to tell your story and tying them together in ways that make sense. And that's what happened here with the song. All right, I'm going to hit the lyrics. We'll come back to this and we'll see what's going on. This is equally as dense, which I suppose I shouldn't be surprised by. I kind of wish I'd counted this. There's got to be 20 stanzas here. There's just a lot of words. And the thing is, it's... I got to like line 9, 10, 11, 12, about 3 stanzas in, and I was like, I don't know what's going on here. Maybe I'll catch on in a little bit, and spoiler alert, I didn't. there is a story here, it seems, about a spring? Water is commonly used. Our very first line, he is a river with endless flow. His source seems eternal under the water. Just a stanza later says, what grace all in place. She's a mountain within a storm. One of our final lines is, drown in the wellspring. And I don't know what is a wellspring? Cause like, a well is where you get water, and a spring is a place of water. So they both have water meanings to me in their base terms, but what is a well spring? A source of continual supply. Oh, doesn't necessarily need to be water-based, such as a well spring of information. Okay, so says drown where there is an abundance of resources, and abandon meaning. Just a little bit before that, we have praise will rise from the ruins and mists. Water. Water is just everywhere through here. It's fascinating to see patterns and not understand them. And I completely forgot there was a choir in this track. Like, that was phenomenal. I forgot to talk about what else vocal-wise. Oh, there's a female vocalist in here who occasionally harmonized with our lead vocalist, and that was gorgeous. I completely forgot to talk about vocals in general. Like I said, I could gush about this all. I could listen to it another time and probably have another hour's worth of stuff to talk about. It is just phenomenally written, but I have no understanding what's going on with these lyrics. It's very fantastically painted. but it might all just be metaphorical for real life things as well. I know I tend to read things very straightforwardly. It's been pointed out a couple of times. I laugh every time I think about it now because I'm like, am I reading this too straightforward? Is all of this an analogy for something? But it's just, it's not how I'm built for poetry analysis. I'm reading what you tell me for the most part. So that's gonna wrap up this. Those are my thoughts on Wilder Runs Passenger. Let me know what you thought of this one. This was just a joy to listen to for me, but you know, maybe that's not the same for you. Let me know. Did you enjoy it? Anything that stood out? Anything you'd like to add on to what I said or correct me on? I had a few questions throughout the reaction as well. Let me know all that down in the comments. Above that, in the description box, you can find a link to Linktree. Takes you to this place right here. You can find my music, the Discord server, ways to support the channel, and so much more. Above that, if you could, like, subscribe, and ring the bell. I greatly appreciate all three of those. I know I was a bit more excitable. This wasn't so much of a dry video. I was just very passionate about this track. I hope that energy was infectious, because I'm happy to talk about this all day long. I really am. Anyways, I'm thinking about the song again. I gotta wrap this video up. I'll be back tomorrow, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 10 p.m. UTC. We're gonna get lost in the confusion again, hopefully wanting a little more out of that. And then we'll do a special selection. Until next time, remember to be critical. Until next time, I gotta enunciate. Until next time, remember to be critical. Remember to be critical? Remember to be critical, not cynical, about the music you listen to, and have a fantastic morning, afternoon, or evening, whenever you choose to watch my videos.